guests, my colleagues of the Science Circle, the alumni, and the members of the Fulbright alumni. I really miss Minister. Thank you very much for coming and attending. It's a great honor for me to be present with you today at this community event. After what the executive of the commission and Mr. Abner from the embassy have said and indicated about and welcoming all of you, I really just don't know what to say afterward. I do agree and join them in welcoming you. Now, therefore, I would appreciate it if I would take the coming few minutes for the time to talk about two things. The very first thing is the activities of the Science Center over the last few years. And then the second thing is to highlight a little bit about what we are going to do in today's conference. So if I will talk about the Science Center of the Fulbright alumni and some of its activities over the last few years, I really should start to indicate that when I search about the word alumni, I find that it is defined as graduate of a school, college, or a university. And it is that the word is derived from Latin, foster son or pupil. In the case of the Fulbright alumni, I believe it is more than that. It is about well-established scientists who learn more about the culture of the two nations and more about their field of interest through the support of the bi-national Fulbright Commission. We are not here today only as an alumni, but as a scholars, and that we were boosted by, in our career in the past, by Senator Fulbright's vision as the executive chairman have indicated. Now for us as an alumni, we just feel that we do more than just exchange of scientific knowledge and ideas. As my colleague and the current team leader of the Science Circle, we remove that also leaves. He thinks that our Science Circle can go way beyond what I just mentioned. And he thinks that it's actually a very long-term collegiate teamwork. And not only for the scholarship and grants to promote our understanding and immediate scientific interest, but it's more important. But it's more important to promote science collaboration and understanding for the benefit of the people in most countries. The Science Circle was established back in 2008, and our objectives can take the format of holding a conference or a seminar or a workshop with the hope of raising awareness with our fellow Egyptians in pointing out challenges, trying to suggest possible solutions, and making the necessary connections with their peers for bridging the knowledge gap. In achieving these objectives, we cooperate with various institutions, such as academia and cultural entities. In this regard, I would like to thank the staff of the Fulbright Commission for their hard work and their continued support in organizing our activities. And on top of this list, as Ms. Megan has mentioned, Ms. Abedi and Ms. Nile and Ms. Iman. Let's give her a hand. Starting from point zero. but it is starting way back, and it's starting from where we live. Please, if you allow me, to mention some of the highlight activities that the center did over the last few years. In July 2011, we did a workshop under the title Enhancing Communication Among Academia and Research Institution at the City of Scientific Research and Technology Application at Cordoba. And a representative from approximately 18 universities and research institutions have attended that event. In April 2012, and building on the previous workshop, we had a one-day conference meeting at EUC to address at the American University of Cairo to address the priority areas that they certainly focus on at the time. And at the time, the field of interest were actually based on solar, renewable energy, the food gap, and wastewater treatment. In September 2012, and in cooperation with the Culture and Humanities Circle, we held a workshop at Amintar's Palace, beautiful palace in old historic Cairo, and it was under the title Nubia, Future Challenges and Hope. And we were honored that Professor Abdelkawa gave and suggested some possible solutions for things that matter about approximately 150 people that attended that event. Since 2013, the members of this circle agreed with what was mentioned, that future activities should really focus on energy and water. We started with the energy, and we started in April 2013. We had a workshop called Young Innovators in Energy, and it was held at the Faculty of Engineering, Cairo University. In April 2014, we did a workshop entitled Young Entrepreneurs in Science and Engineering in cooperation with the National Research Center. In May 2015, we held a conference called Egypt Towards Sustainable Energy at the Energy Lab of the Faculty of Engineering, Cairo University. And today, we hope we can address a vital and a very important issue related to water, which is the river Nile. Most people would argue that overpopulation is right now the most challenging problem that is facing the world. By 2014, for example, people who live on the Nile basin countries, in the Nile riparian countries, overall, they were about 450 million. It is expected that within the coming 75 years, they will increase by 500 million more. To end up by 2050, to have 950 million people living in the Nile riparian countries. Although this may not seem to be a water resources problem to address right now, but we need to remember that all of these people must be fed and housed, and they must live in their countries with a minimum impact on the environment. Therefore, adequate water supplies must be found and maintained for this population in the future. It's a big challenge. In addition, the people who actually live on the Nile basin are facing ever-growing problems, such as climate change, soil degradation, and health stress. The conference will address important issues that need to be tackled in order to live along the banks of the Nile in a sustainable way, and investigate possible solutions for these challenges. The keynote speech to today will be presented by Professor Dr. Abdel Fattah Tawar, and will focus on the impacts of climate change on the Nile Basin as a whole, not only in Egypt, and what can be done to mitigate them. In the science and engineering session, which is chaired by Dr. Abdel Fattah Tawar, the hydrology of the River Nile and the hills, the agriculture and the environmental constraints will be addressed. In the legal and the humanities session, which is the second session, which is chaired by Professor Dr. Manasterly, thank you very much for doing that. Issues related to River Nile, Egyptian history, and modern Egyptian literature will be discussed. In addition, an overview of the legal and political dimensions of the Nile Water Agreements will also be discussed. Finally, the conference, today's conference will end with a discussion to cover what you, dear audience, all of you and participants, would like to raise from any of the points and issues related to the topic of the conference. In addition, we are hoping that Mr. Ambassador Sharif Aissa, the Deputy Assistant Minister for Water Affairs at the Egyptian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, will be able to join us despite of his very busy schedule. We would like to end this conference by a set of recommendations for future steps that need to be taken in order to live along the Nile in a sustainable way. Today we have prominent guest speakers, and I would like to thank all of them for their participation. In the order of getting their talks today, we have Professor Dr. Hassim Mansour, who will kindly address issues related to water, agriculture, food. Our distinguished and prominent writer, Dr. Wasim Sisi, who will talk about the River Nile and ancient Egyptian civilization. Dr. Jasper Musa, who will address issues related to international law and Nile Basin legal regime. I am delighted to indicate that the key people from academia, industry, private business, with us today, and I'm looking forward for their active participation during the conference. Professor Dr. Luis Cavanaguda, we are highly honored to have you here again, and we really appreciate it. Thank you very much.